So, as promised, I'm live and on time in Liverpool, just hanging around the periphery of the Labour Party conference with Peter. How are you doing?
It's a small world, isn't it?
Yeah, funny that we should bump into each other like this.
Sure.
I mean, anyone would think it would pre-planned.
Yeah.
What next with Junior Doctors? What's your take on it? Have you been following it much?
Well, I've got in front of me, actually, an article that has just appeared online in The Telegraph, which I think really sums things up right now. And it says this. Let me just read this article, just the first paragraph. Junior doctors who forced the BMA to drop its dangerous strikes deserve praise and a new union. Junior doctors will not walk out for 5 days next week or any other week. The British Medical Association has pulled out of the game of chicken it was playing against Jeremy Hunt, finally accepting that the only effect of its woefully reckless plan will be to harm patients and, less importantly, doctors' reputations. I mean, let's just have a think about that. I mean, The Telegraph is basically saying that the BMA has pulled out of industrial action for fear that it may cause harm to patients. Now, I can tell you that during this dispute, there has been harm to patients and possibly even death to patients, but that has not been caused by any actions on the part of junior doctors or the BMA. It's been caused by the actions of the Health Secretary,
yeah,
Jeremy Hunt. And you just need to look at the phenomena of the Hunt effect, which was created by Jeremy Hunt putting out in the public domain reckless misinformation,
yeah,
about
and
weekend,
you know,
death
at
rates.
At that point, from the BMA, where was the response? Where was the rebuttal? Hey, Richard, where was the rebuttal? Where was the response saying, actually, there's a misrepresentation of information? Mm. We also saw it when Dr. Johan Malawana, the ex-chair of the JDC,
yeah,
gave it his personal recommendation to the contract. Since then, it has been spun in the media that the BMA have backed this contract. There was no press release from the BMA at all to clarify that point.
Let's just come back to this article in the Telegraph this evening, because I think it's really, really important. Now, the Health Secretary's position on weekend death rates has been completely rubbished and completely ridiculed. But because he recklessly gave misinformation, deliberately recklessly gave misinformation to the public about weekend death rates, we saw patients not going to hospital at the weekend because they wrongly believed, because of what the health secretary had said, that they had a greater chance of dying if they went into hospital at the weekend. Now, the report that Jeremy Hunt was quoting from initially actually concluded it would be rash and misleading to actually say to anybody that any of these deaths could be avoided.
Yeah.
So, you know, what part of rash and misleading did the health secretary not get? But I can tell you that I've had stories sent to me personally by doctors of patients that have been severely injured, that have suffered awful pain because they did not go into hospital at the weekend because they wrongly believed, because of what the health secretary had said, that they had a greater chance of dying. Now,
As a doctor, I've seen people not coming.
But
it's
we
an
then
absolute
come
disgrace.
Back there. We then come back to this point about industrial action, because junior doctors have been backed into a corner here. They've tried everything possible to persuade the health secretary to be reasonable on this issue, and he's refused to do so. So what junior doctors have said is industrial action is the only way that we can actually stop patients from being injured. It's the only way we can actually save patients from being killed. So it's crazy for the Telegraph. Well, we know why, of course, you know, right-wing Tory press again.
Yeah.
But it's just crazy. It seems to me that it's just quite frankly crazy that industrial action has been cancelled because junior doctors had no other recourse. Where do you go from here?
I agree completely. But the thing is, apparently they're trying innovative measures. They're trying other approaches. Why were these not done 3 years
exactly
ago?
Exactly, 3 years ago. I mean, the whole point, as I have always understood it, and indeed the whole point as I now see it, is that industrial action was being taken by junior doctors to actually save patients' lives.
Yeah.
You know, that was the whole
point.
You know, the whole point of industrial action was, we've been backed into a corner. You know, we care about our patients. Our patients are going to be injured. Our patients could be killed if we let this health secretary stretch 5 days of doctors over 7 days with no more doctors and no more resources.
Ruth made a really good comment saying, haha, someone that talks more than you. I guess it's a friendly interview. It's not even an interview. It's just a chat, really. We're just completely ad-libbing, just saying hi.
Nobody talks more than I do.
Well, you've been paid for it to do it for years, though, haven't you?
Well, it's true. I'm a lawyer. Yeah, that's true. Yeah.
So one question from Ian, which is quite good, is where is the evidence that junior doctor strike would cause harm to patients? The evidence is to the contrary. So how could the BMA say this?
Yeah, exactly. I don't understand it because, you see, we come back to the health secretary quite simply, and it's not a difficult concept to understand, wanting to stretch 5 days of junior doctors over 7 days with no more doctors and no more resources. Now, junior doctors are already stretched
like
to the limit.
Exactly. What happens with
it
cling
will
film?
Break. Well, that's a rather nice analogy, isn't it? Of course, the cling film will tear. It
I
will
borrowed
break.
It from Greg.
It will be break. Now, you're therefore going to find that patients are going to be injured, patients are going to be potentially killed by the health secretary's proposals. And the health secretary has tried to railroad through this new contract on the back of misrepresenting research. I mean, his entire position on weekend death rates was ridiculed by a number of studies just a few months before the BMA went back into negotiation with the health secretary.
Yeah, no, absolutely.
I mean, what happened there? I mean, you have a situation.
Oh, hold on. In terms of the negotiations, I mean, that's a critical time. And before I go into this little point, what I'd like you guys to do that are watching, tag your friends into it, put it into some Facebook groups. We'll hang around for as long as there's an audience and there's interaction with you guys. So when they went back into negotiations, a key thing to mention is that there was a WhatsApp leak, and this isn't in the mainstream press, and my personal understanding, my reading of it, is that the GADC, the negotiating team, were held over a barrel with this WhatsApp leak by Jeremy Hunt. I don't know about you, but I wouldn't want to go into a room negotiating with him. But then, when the BMA visited the roadshow, and I spoke to them, I said, look, get ahead of the news curve, just put out all this WhatsApp leak. The Health Service Journal have got it anyway. You want to control it and just put it out so it can't be used against you. Do you know what the answer was that I got?
What?
The answer was the BMA, it's very damaging for the BMA. The BMA needs to undergo a process of healing because at the moment it'll be very hurtful and damaging for the BMA if we put this out. I'm sorry, that's not what members...
Well, let's just go back to the day before the BMA went back into negotiations. I think it was in March with the health secretary. And look at the circumstances that existed at that point in time. Now, we had a contract, a new proposed contract for junior doctors, which in many ways had been based upon the health secretary misrepresenting weekend death rates. We had a contract which we knew was unsafe for patients, because of course it's attempting to stretch 5 days of doctors over 7 days. But more than that, we had a contract that was discriminatory against women. It discriminated against part-time workers.
And Heidi Alexander came in saying that she wanted to trial it.
And let's not forget the government's own equality impact assessment had said that this contract openly discriminates. So that's a bit of background there. But we also have, just before the BMA go back into the negotiation, Hunt's position on weekend death rates having been completely rubbished by two or three studies which had suddenly come out, or one after the other. So the health secretary has been completely rubbished and ridiculed. Junior doctors have this huge mandate for industrial
98%.
Action. 98% at the time. Enormous solidarity. I've seen that myself. And so you go into this negotiation and you come out it seemed to me less than you actually went in with.
Yeah, because Saturday and Sunday was negotiated away. That was never part of the negotiation.
It was always about Saturday, but then suddenly you lose Sunday as well. I mean, you can't make this...
it's the lighting, Sandra. I'm not that dead on my feet. It's the lighting. It's fine.
You really can't make this up. But then what happened was just, quite frankly, even more bizarre. And, of course, I'm not a junior doctor, so I'm looking at this from a completely objective objective, independent position.
Not completely independent, in the sense that you're an expert on patient safety. Sure, you spent 25 years litigating and knowing what patient safety and what dangers are.
Looking at this from as an outsider, so somebody who isn't a junior doctor, you've got the JDC, which is the Junior Doctors Committee, having a vote on what to do about this new contract. And what the JDC does is it recognises that there are both good and bad in that contract, and therefore it decides, it takes a vote, and the vote is to adopt a neutral position. So that neutral position is then going to go to a ballot of junior doctors. So you're going to have a vote. Now, the vote, of course, is to reject the contract, and quite rightly so, to my mind. But what happened between the JDC taking the vote to adopt the neutral position and the actual vote itself was even more bizarre, because you've got the chair of the JDC in the intervening period running around the country, giving roadshows, promoting the contract.
So let me just say something.
It's important, because you've got the chair of the JDC running around the country promoting this contract at a point when the JDC itself has voted to adopt a neutral position. So you've got the chair of the JDC ignoring the vote of the JDC to adopt a neutral position and then running around the country.
Spending millions, keep up
saying
with
should accept
Terry,
it.
That's exactly that what we're doing. We're giving you the facts, Terry. That's exactly what we're doing. And also, you can get all the facts yourself, because the Justice for Health team have done a fantastic job in collating everything. It won't really show up on the camera, but go to their website, and there's two documents, one a skeleton argument for the case, and one a timeline of everything that's happened. Yeah. So go to the Justice for Health website, download those documents, and you can be fully informed of all the facts.
Yeah. Just saying something about the Justice for Health team here, who have done an absolutely incredible, extraordinary job. Now,
that's a job that the BMA should
exactly,
be doing.
But just to talk about Justice for Health team, because we're talking about five junior doctors there, and I've been a litigator for 25 years, and I know how stressful it is for your client when you take litigation. And I think it's really important that every junior doctor in this country understands the enormous pressure and stress that those five doctors in Justice for Health
must have
been under.
Absolutely phenomenal.
In terms of potential cost liabilities and so on. But yeah, you're absolutely right. How on earth can it be the case that these five courageous junior doctors in Justice for Health had to actually crowdfund to raise the money to take the health secretary
it's
to
just
court?
It's a lack of leadership, it's a lack of direction.
Surely this is something that should have been funded by the BMA. Why didn't the BMA fund this?
I agree, and going back to your previous point about the roadshows, they've spent millions probably, I don't know, but I guess it's a lot, you know, hotel fees, travel, venues going around, promoting this contract all over the country.
That's a good point. I mean, if the JDC voted to adopt a neutral position, and then the chair of the JDC decides to go off on one on his own, running around the country with roadshows promoting it, why should junior doctors be paying for that?
I agree.
You know, surely that money should have gone to Justice for Health.
But equally, or Chris Day, we've had a few comments about whistleblowing. And they've all scrolled up, so I can't see them. But I mean, the general gist
of course,
is
now we're onto it. Well, now we're onto another issue, because I'm lucky enough to count Chris Day as a friend. I've met him on a number of occasions. I've met his family, his young family. He's got two young children. Chris Day was abandoned by the BMA. He's had to fight this case on whistleblowing protection,
tooth and nail,
that will affect
on his
every
own.
Single junior doctor in the country.
Yeah,
on
where's
his own.
Support
again
been?
With all the enormous stress that being a litigant yourself puts on you, and I've seen this, you know, over many years of being a litigator.
Amanda, I don't think any national newspapers are on our side, to be honest, and I think that's why we've got to do it ourselves through social media, because I don't know, my personal belief is we don't need expensive PR, we don't need people to help us with our messaging. We're doctors at the end of the day. We're professional communicators. We've got all the kit and all the equipment to do it ourselves. So why don't we just go out and do it?
Well, I kind of agree with that. What you need is your union to actually go out there and get the message out there. You know, I mean, I've seen various members of the BMA on the telly, you know, talking about this. But why is it that we've not seen anyone on the telly saying quite simply to the public, the reason we were bringing industrial action, the reason we made the decision to go for industrial action is because we actually care about patient safety and we care about saving patients' lives. And if we don't take this action, patients will be injured and patients will be killed. That's
Ian's just made a really good comment. Before it scrolls off, he said, the BMA dumped Chris Dagg. You've got to question why, and I agree. And in terms of, what was your point? What were you just saying before I changed tax on that? I've forgotten. Help me out.
I've got no idea
what you were saying. You have no idea.
Okay, well, we were talking about Chris Day and the fact that the BMA had abandoned him. You know, talking about Chris Day,
the BMA have never behaved like a union. It's more like a springboard for political careers. Controversial. You know, Sarah, did your fingers slip on the keyboard?
I mean, the extraordinary thing. The extraordinary thing that I see about the BMA is that every time it should actually be taking action, it fails to do so. So this case that is being brought by Justice for Health, being brought by five courageous doctors all on their own, should have been brought by the BMA, and they should have supported
Chris
Day.
What about Hunt's lawyers? Why should the public pay for Hunt's lawyers? I said lawyers. Hunt's lawyers. Why should the public pay for them?
Well, the taxpayer, of course, is paying for Hunt's defence, and Hunt's legal team are trying to argue that he's acting within his powers by making a decision and trying to railroad through a contract that is going to stretch 5 days of doctors over 7 days that will potentially injure or even kill
Terry
patients.
Terry says because the government wants you guys to look bad. So, I mean, let's move the conversation on in terms of you're a lawyer, you've done this for years, you've been in the Royal Courts of Justice, was it?
Yeah,
you went there
times.
Week in, week out, and like, I went there for the first time, it was amazing. How do you see this playing out in terms of, you know, we saw some of the legal challenges with the Labour Party. What do you think is going to happen with this case? Now, I'm not wanting to put you on the spot, but...
My view is, of course, the case should succeed on its merits. And I hope the case will succeed, and I hope that the court will find that the Health Secretary has acted ultra vires in excess or beyond the scope of the powers that he has. But of course, what might then happen is that Hunt's legal team could decide to appeal that decision. Permission to appeal is usually refused, but you can then make an application to the court for permission to appeal. And of course, we've seen something very similar quite recently in the litigation brought by members of the Labour Party against the Labour Party / NEC, in which they argued that the Labour Party had acted in excess of its powers by taking away members' right to vote and, in essence, imposing a price tag on democracy of £25. Now, of course, they succeeded in the Court of First Instance, so the High Court sided with the members of the Labour Party, but the NEC then made the decision to immediately appeal that decision, and, of course, the Court of Appeal overturned it. So,
hey Ed, you're right. Hope you're well. Jeanette, I think it was Jeanette. I don't know. Let me scroll back. Somebody said, Janine Tipping. They started selling off the NH in 2010. What makes you think you can save it now? Social media. In 2010, we didn't have the capability to be as connected
and
do this.
There is a very big reason why we can save the NHS now, and that's two words: Jeremy Corbyn.
That's a good point. Yeah. I mean, if Owen Smith got in, Pfizer linked.
If Owen Smith had won the leadership contest, it would be game over.
No,
but
I
of course,
agree.
Jeremy Corbyn is a man of principle.
Yeah, and I agree completely
will
with that.
Not
and to be fair,
let the NHS be privatised.
I completely
and of course,
agree.
That's why the establishment, or one of the reasons why the establishment, want him gone.
Not just that, but also, I think, you know, he's a bloke that is more than happy just to chat to me, just starting out in this. He didn't have to talk to me. He didn't have to give NHS interviews. He didn't have to give his time. And the fact that he was able to do that, you know, I can't see Theresa May wanting to sit down with me or any other junior doctor. I can't see Jeremy Hunt wanting to sit down with me or any other junior doctor. And I think we've got to look at this as a positive. And I think, the movement behind Jeremy Corbyn, you know, whether you agree with some of his policies or not, the NHS is a flagship one, and
We're moving on to away from junior doctors now and onto politics. And because you and I are two of those new members of the Labour Party. Kish and I both joined the Labour Party pretty much around the same because we both wanted to support Jeremy Corbyn. From my personal perspective, I was inspired to join the Labour Party by Jeremy Corbyn because he's a man of principle, he's a man of integrity, and he's a man that won't get down on bended knee to the establishment, and he's a man that we can get behind, you know, principles that we can really believe in. And I think people in this country are ready for a new type of politics based on honesty and truth and facts and information we can actually believe in. And it seems to me that Jeremy
Corbyn's
building
some sort of community, really, doesn't it?
Yeah. And like, I mean, Jeremy Corbyn's a lone voice of truth in a political system that I think is now based on lies and misinformation.
It's coming incredibly close, Richard, in terms of me doorstepping Jeremy Hunt. I may very well have to do that at some point. I'm quite quick and nifty with the kit now, so it'll be live very quickly. Hold on. What next for Chris Day? Please plug. We're trying to raise another 5K so we can fight his case on his own in a couple of weeks' time.
Help Chris Day. Help Chris
Go,
Day.
Scroll down a little bit, you know, two posts. He's done a video
Chris
explaining
Day
it.
Is a young doctor, you know, one of the nicest, kindest people I've met. He's got a young family. He's been put under extraordinary pressure.
Strung out to dry.
Because the BMA abandoned him and his case.
Yeah.
And let's not forget, you know, Chris Day is fighting for whistleblowing protection rights for every junior doctor in this country.
He's fighting for something that's actually completely critical for safety.
Exactly.
And for patient safety and for the NHS.
Whistleblowing protection is inextricably linked to patient safety. Doctors have to know that they can speak out if something is going wrong in the way in which the system is being worked, if patients are potentially being harmed. So please help Chris Day. And, you know, I know I've mentioned this a couple of times. The same applies to Justice for Health. You know, they need our help as well. Being a litigant, you know, being a claimant, you know, just because there's crowdfunding behind you doesn't prevent you from being put under the most extraordinary pressure.
I saw it. I spoke to Ben, I spoke to Nadia before the case.
Yeah.
And you could see it. Of course they're under pressure. And they're to be commended for that because... You know, it's very easy for people to knock the BMA, and it's very, in my personal opinion, quite fairly, but it's very easy to just knock. You've got to go and do something else. You've got to go and contribute and do something else, whether that's go and take the health secretary to court, whether that's set up something like this, social media broadcaster, crowdfund various initiatives. You know, the sad thing is there's so many things that are now happening. It's a complete lack of leadership from the BMA. And it's not a case of rebuilding the BMA. I'm sorry. I've seen some comments about we just need to rebuild. We're all working hard. Come on. I mean, it's in a week's time in October, this contract is going to be introduced now. It's not going to be imposed. It's going to be introduced. And we need to be careful of that.
Is that the word being used now?
Introduced. Instead of imposed, introduced. Or implemented. So it's a technical...
It's imposition.
So what next, Andrew? Hi, Kishan. What next, mate? I think we keep going. I think we've got to. I think we've got to put pressure on the BMA to actually start representing doctors. I think we've got to spread the word. I think we've got to incentivise people. We've got 78 people watching now, and this will go quite well, I would have thought. It's gone on for a while, but we've got to get people involved in the conversation that are not interested. Everybody in this is now interested.
The enormous shame is that just a few months ago, there was this enormous solidarity between.
So you said that already,
doctors.
And Della's just said, "What if you don't sign en masse?" Thing is, Della, if you work in a contract for a period of time in the NHS, it's just accepted that you have it. Ed Clark, what about a multi-union approach? I think fair enough. Mamdou's approached the BMA a while ago. Mamdou Barakat, they kind of said no, they didn't really listen to him. I think multi-union approach would be very interesting.
But not just a multi-union approach for junior doctors, but for every public service, firefighters, ambulance workers, you know, paramedics, nurses.
Absolutely.
You know, we've reached a point in this country where every union needs to come together. You know, we all have to stand and fight together. It's that simple.
I think one little point on health is people think if you're healthy, it's not going to affect you. People think if you're healthy, it's not going to affect you and it doesn't matter. But this affects everybody. At some point in their life, the NHS will affect everybody, whether it's the cost of your prescriptions, whether it's the cost of putting your parents into some kind of care, whether it's the cost of treatments and medications for your kids. So it's absolutely essential that everybody is interested in this. And yes, people want to watch X Factor. Yes, people are more interested in, I don't know, various kind of trashy TV, like Strictly Come Dancing with Ed Balls on it. I mean, that's terrible. That made him relevant again. But we really, really, really got to get other people involved. And there's a mailing list on the top, on the pinned post. The video that I did outside Justice for Health, which has now got to about 880,000 people. There's a mailing list on that. Sign up. We can send you updates. We can send you details. Other innovative approaches. I mean, I spent today talking to Dr. Phil Hammond, who's a stand-up comedian, who's MD for Private Eye, who's a GP, and I'm proud to say that WattMed Media is now going to promote his tour. So he's going to 60 dates across the country, talking about the NHS, talking about patient safety. Mm. So we really need to look at innovative approaches that don't cost the earth, it just costs our time. I steady on about Strictly, sorry, and I might divide an audience.
While we're live, I have to just mention something
about the miners' rally
tomorrow. One of the reasons that I am in Liverpool, quite apart from attending the Labour Party conference, is because there will be a rally tomorrow at 12 noon at Derby Square.
Turn up if you're around, come.
Our former miners. And our former miners are fighting for justice. And the reason they're fighting for justice is that successive governments have robbed £8 billion from the miners' pension fund, leaving miners and their families destitute.
I mean, I think that's absolutely outrageous, because these are miners. It's a horrible thing to do, but also, miners, given their working environment, given their conditions, I can speak from a medical point of view, they're not going to have as long a life expectancy as if they're working in an office job. Mm. So that the actuarists, I'm led to believe, that were actually dealing with the miners' pension negotiations knew that they wouldn't be having that long of service, and it wouldn't cost that much. So how much has it actually cost the government?
I mean, the underwriting the miners' pension scheme has not cost the government a single penny, and that's come straight from the Treasury. But successive governments have robbed the miners' pension fund of £8 billion. And we're talking about successive governments here, so not just the Tory government, we're also talking about Labour as well. John Major's government were the first robber baron of if I can put it that way, the miners' pension fund. But Tony Blair comes along, and he's happy to continue with this. In 2003, the Blair government actually robbed the miners' pension fund of £400 million in a year. It cost the Blair government nothing.
Outrageous.
And some miners were getting a pension of £10 a week. Now, I mean, I've been a lawyer for 20 years, and I've seen a lot of injustice, but it's difficult for me to even conceive of a situation where a government can rob miners' pension fund of 400 million quid in a year. It costs them nothing, and miners get a tenner a week. That's what some of them were getting. And let's not forget, you know, we're talking about...
Just because we haven't covered this yet, and I want to say, Angela Thurlow robbed us 50s-born ladies of our pensions too. Yeah. Many have worked from 15 to 16. Now, ill health, not easy to get a job in your 60s. Completely agree.
It's just absolutely great.
The government,
even now, is telling the people in this country, save for your retirement. Yeah. Put money
cobblers
in your pension
absolute
fund.
Now,
what kind of message does it send to the public in this country from the government when they then go and rob our miners of £8 billion, leaving miners and their families destitute? It's an absolute goddamn outrage.
I completely agree. And I was just going to say,
about miners, for goodness sake, you know, these guys worked in the most dangerous, dark conditions imaginable to keep our homes, our hospitals, and our schools warm.
Yep.
They kept the wheels of industry turning
in
wartime and peacetime, and this is the reward that we give them. An absolute outrage. I mean,
Do you think that potentially it's kind of that they felt that they would be able to have their voice suppressed? Because my interest in all this is the fact that I look at, having, you know, learned a bit about the miners through you, and I'm not going to pretend I'm an expert on it, because it's just through chatting with Peter and planning for tomorrow. Mm. If you look at how the miners were portrayed in the media, it's very similar to how they're trying to portray junior doctors.
Well,
and all these things happen on cycles of around 40 years, because people forget, people die, people didn't know in the first place.
Yeah, there are some analogies there between the junior doctors' strikes and the miners' strikes. I suppose the starting point of the analogy would be, if you look at the government's argument on pits being, or certain pits being uneconomic.
Well, yeah, it's completely
back in
the
day.
Hospitals.
But of course, those pits were only uneconomic because the government wasn't putting money
into
them.
Which is exactly what they're doing with the NHS.
It was underfunding. Same thing happened, of course, or is happening with the NHS. But also, of course, the other analogy is that miners were attacked by a biased right-wing press. And, you know, there was a lot of information that the public should have had that they didn't have. And we know what happened there. You know, it was a political war by the Tory government against the miners. They wanted to punish miners, and they're now trying to punish miners and their families literally all the way to the grave by robbing them of their pensions. So, it's an absolute outrage. I find it hard to talk about this without just exploding
with anger.
Don't blame
you. Don't blame you. Your speech is going to be pretty explosive tomorrow, then.
It will be an angry speech. Do I ever give anything other than an angry speech? But
well,
there's a lot to be
no.
angry about in this country at the moment, certainly.
No, I agree. I tell you what, we're going to keep going until this cuts out, because I'm putting it into some groups now. Look, do you see how the numbers just jump? So keep. I'm going to give you the mic. Can you hold that a sec?
Yeah, sure.
Just go for it.
Right, okay, well, let me just tell you a bit of background, a little bit more detail to the miners' dispute. Back in 1994, John Major's government decides to privatise the mining industry. And at the same time, the government agrees to underwrite the miners' pension fund. But in return for underwriting the miners' pension fund, the government takes a whopping 50% of any surplus. Now, it's a mystery to me how miners got railroaded into this deal, but over the years, the deals cost the government nothing, not a single penny, but successive governments have actually robbed the miners' pension fund of £8 billion.
Outrageous.
I think that's actually a conservative estimate. I think it's a few billion pounds more than that. But let's put it into context. At the same time as robbing the miners' pension fund of £8 billion, the same government has bailed out its greedy, negligent banker friends to the tune of £124 billion. So actually, you know, arguably, money was taken from the miners' pension fund
to
bail out greedy, negligent bankers.
I mean, just
it's
to come
absolute,
in on that point really quickly, in terms of bailing out bankers, I can remember then after the crash, and I believe this because I was politically and media naive then, they said, we need the best bankers in the country, they contribute to the economy, and we need to keep them.
Yeah.
Do we not need the best doctors in this country?
Of course, of course.
And I'm to take it a bit off the miners, because we're going to do a lot for the miners tomorrow, but
I read
just double standards.
There has been a huge increase in applications made by doctors to go and work abroad.
Yeah, there has.
Just during the last week. You know,
would you blame them?
Rocketed.
Would you blame
not.
Them?
Of course not. Why would you want to continue to work as a junior doctor in this country when the government is deliberately misrepresenting facts to the public in order to stretch you over 7 days when you're at breaking point right now? You know, it's just
extraordinary. But the trouble is, I mean, I think I'm glad we got back onto doctors, because there's lots of junior doctors, there are lots of medical students out there that are absolutely rudderless. They have no idea where to turn. They have no. They don't know who they're going to talk to.
Well,
the BMA should be looking out for them. And one thing that I would say is I remember MTAS, I remember modernising medical careers, and I remember generations of doctors being lost from that. All we are seeing in an incredibly short cycle is history repeating itself. And my concern is that fatigue will mean people will just accept it. People think there's no alternative. I'd say there's a massive alternative. You've got to fight. You've got to, you know, I haven't said this yet, and I'm really reluctant to say it, but maybe it's coming to the point where people just need to cancel their BMA membership so that they wake up and realise that if they don't have the members and they don't have the money coming in, then they can't behave in this way that is completely unrepresentative of what the vast majority of members and the public thinks.
I think something else really important to mention on this point is this. We've been talking about patient safety, but we're also talking about doctor safety here as well. You know, I've said this many times. I was told by one consultant that he had seen two junior doctor colleagues killed driving home after an excessively long shift because they were tired. And I think there was a study conducted very recently which said an enormous percentage of junior doctors had actually fallen asleep at the wheel driving home.
Yeah.
So we're talking about doctor safety here as well as patient safety. And of course, tired doctors will make mistakes when they're treating patients.
For the members of the public watching, I'd say, would you want to get on a plane with a pilot that's falling asleep at the in the cockpit? Would you want to be operated on by a surgeon that is falling asleep? Of course you wouldn't. But there's this narrative that's being portrayed in the mainstream media that doctors are greedy, mercenary, and that all we're interested in is money. And you've started this with an assault on the consultants now. Did you see that? They've started, you know, consultants' earnings and all that sort of stuff. I don't know how they can stand there with a straight face and lie. I don't understand either. I really don't get it.
I mean, it was extraordinary that Theresa May made the decision to keep Jeremy Hunt as health secretary. I know that your position on this, Kishan,
do you think she kept it because she couldn't get anyone else in?
Yeah,
and he's a scapegoat.
That's your position. You told me that before. What I find so extraordinary is that we are talking about a new prime minister who makes a decision to keep in place a health secretary who is known to have deliberately misrepresented facts to the public on weekend death rates in order to railroad through this contract for junior doctors.
He's perfectly suited to the job, though, isn't he?
Yeah, but you don't
because,
want...
he's written a book on how to privatise it, and that's what they want to do.
Theresa May decides to keep in place a health secretary who has caused pain and injury and suffering, possibly even death, to patients, because those patients did not go into hospital at weekend because they wrongly believed, because of what he had said, that they had a greater chance of dying if they went into hospital at weekends. And, of course, that whole premise was completely rubbished by that whole raft of surveys earlier this year.
In all honesty, mate, I think that Hunt is probably laughing. Have you noticed how he's just dropped off the radar? He has no profile. Doesn't need to. The BMA are tearing themselves apart, leaving junior doctors absolutely desolate.
Why is that? Why do you think the BMA is tearing itself apart? I mean, just a few months ago, the BMA had this enormous mandate. Was it
98%?
Enormous solidarity of junior doctors. You were all standing together, shoulder to shoulder, and you knew what you were fighting for. You were fighting primarily for patient safety, because you knew as doctors that if you were stretched over 7 days with no more doctors and no more resources, then you would snap. It would be that simple.
I think my take on it is that fatigue set in, the negotiating team, not that this is an excuse, but fatigue probably set in, and they felt it was the best deal that they could get. And maybe personal pride took over. Maybe they thought they believed the cult and the celebrity personality that they'd established for themselves running around in the media. And just because it may have been the best deal that they could negotiate does not mean that it is the best deal for doctors. And the trouble is that they've run around the country...
When you say they believe it was the best deal they could negotiate, what does that mean exactly?
In terms of, well, if you... I'm just hypothesising here, I don't know, but if you're held over a barrel with a gun to your head in the name of a WhatsApp leak that I already know that the BMA don't want to release because it's damaging, if that's the best negotiation that you can get to with Jeremy Hunt, who I don't think he's going to be the best guy to negotiate with, then maybe they thought that's the best they could do. But the thing is, they come out, they say a neutral line and say, we're putting it to members, that's it. Yeah. I can see no reason why somebody needs to run around the country. In terms of Johan Mulawana, Dr. Johan Mulawana, the ex-chair at the JDC, ran around the country telling people, and personally telling people, that, yeah, it's a good contract, do it. I myself know, I questioned some of the kind of behaviour in terms of whether this was right or not, got attacked by a group of attack dogs on Facebook, got everything screenshotted, so it's been deleted, but don't worry, I've got records off it, so that's fine. And I just think the Junior Doctor Forum, as a result, has become an absolutely miserable place on Facebook.
It's almost there was some sort of purpose behind that. It's just extraordinary.
Just to sell it to doctors.
I mean, for those that are joining us that weren't with us when we were talking about this earlier, the JDC, which is the Junior Doctors Committee, which represents junior doctors via the BMA, made the decision to adopt a neutral position on the contract. There was a vote by the JDC to adopt a neutral position on the contract because the JDC quite properly recognised that there was good and bad in that contract and decided to put it to a vote of junior doctors. Now, between the JDC taking the vote to adopt a neutral position and put it to a referendum of junior doctors and the actual referendum itself taking place, the chair of the JDC, for reasons which are quite frankly bizarre, decided to ignore the JDC vote to adopt a neutral position and ran around the country operating these expensive
roadshows, trying
to persuade
doctors to accept the contract. Thankfully, doctors saw through that.
It resulted in a lot of division between junior doctors, and a lot of needless division, because quite simply, the chair was trying to sell to junior doctors a contract that was unfair, that was unsafe,
discriminatory,
and that discriminated against women.
Yeah.
And why on earth would the chair of the JDC do that when the JDC that he is the chair of has adopted a neutral position on the contract?
If I remember the timeline correctly, I think there was a window before the JDC met in between that, But I mean, they're still carried on, and it's just, I don't know.
Well, explain that. What do you mean by
a window?
I think
there was a window where the JDC hadn't met, and then there was a conveniently timed window where Johan's personal recommendation was given for this contract to people. Then the JDC met. Then they came out and said they're taking a neutral stance. Well, then they went and carried on with the road shows. But the sad thing is, on the Junior Doctor Contract Forum, that did not continue.
Well, my recollection of the roadshows is that they ran throughout the entire period between the JDC vote to adopt a neutral position and the referendum itself. And if you're chair of the JDC, well, then, you know, you have a personal opinion, of course, but you express or represent the views of the, I presume, the JDC vote, and the vote was to adopt a neutral position. So right up to the point of the actual Junior Doctor's vote to reject the contract, as I recollect it, the chair was running around saying you should accept it because I don't think
Absolutely.
We can do better.
Thanks,
well, it's just
Kim.
Not good enough.
It's the junior doctors doing all the work whilst the consultant is running between hospitals. The junior doctors are awesome. Just wish the government showed these people some respect.
Yeah.
I agree. The reason that they don't want to show doctors respect is because for them to privatise it, what they need to do is they need to underfund it, they need to make it dangerous or look dangerous and not kind of a good service. Mm. Then all they need to say, I will Helena and the WhatsApp leaks in one sec, and then what they need to do is they say, oh look, it's broken, the only way we can fix it is to privatise it, would you like Virgin Health to do it? And then the next thing that's going to happen, apparently, talking to some people, is there's going to be a cross-party consensus that represents both sides of the party, obviously Labour and Conservatives, and the recommendation from that is going to be top-up insurance and top-up payments, which is a softening people up towards privatisation. We've seen Royal Mail get sold off by this government for less than the market rate. We've seen every other industry in this country be sold off and the transfer of public money into private hands. And I do an MBA. I think I'm all for corporations, I'm all for businesses, but there's got to be an ethical and there's a certain element of corporate social responsibility in terms of how these organisations run. Going back to Helena, in terms of the WhatsApp leak...
That's why we need Jeremy Corbyn, of course.
Yeah, absolutely. And that's why the establishment are kind of scared of that, and it would change matters a lot. Yeah. In terms of the WhatsApp leak, Helena, basically, there's about 1,000 pages, maybe, of WhatsApp communication between members of the JDC, the Junior Doctors Committee negotiating, and this was released to Sean Linton at the Health Service Journal, and Sean Linton has released some of it, he will release more of it. This is a leak that has been quoted by Jeremy Hunt in Parliament. And it was, when I spoke to the BMA comms people, the media comms, they said to me, it's very damaging for the BMA. The BMA has undergo a process of hurt and we need to, or sorry, it's very hurtful and damaging for the BMA and we need to undergo a process of healing. And I was just shocked because all I asked was, why don't you put it out in the public domain? You know, Sean Linton can put it out whenever he wants. Why not get ahead of the news curve? And why not just get rid of this? I've asked questions on the contract forum about the WhatsApp leak. They're not answering me. They're just ignoring me. At least they're not attacking me, which is good. So I'd say that's progress. That is progress. I'm thankful for that. So thank you for the kind of BMA stooges, as Bob Gilwood put it, for not kind of slaughtering me on the forum. I really appreciate that because I can actually concentrate on get on with trying to fight and represent junior doctors as best as I can. Because bear in mind, I would get, from purely monetary reasons, this contract would be great for me. I'd get a £6,000 pay rise, if not more. Yeah. I'm not fighting for this because, I'm fighting for this not because I'm going to get a pay cut and I'm concerned about it. I'm fighting about it because I'm concerned of what it's going to do to the medical profession, what it's going to do to medical students, what it's going to do to students that are leaving school at 18, going into medical school, finishing at 23, and coming out with £100,000 worth of debt, and there's also job insecurity for them at the other end. Mm. How do we encourage people to enter medicine if
but
that's
also
the situation?
Coming back to patient safety again, stretching
and that,
5 days
yeah,
doctors
and that, of course.
Over 7 days with the potential for patients to be injured, potentially even killed.
I'm 250 people watching, so I hate to leave. So, has anyone got any little questions? Any of the controlled opposition? That's okay, Helena, you're welcome. Gary Sim, the controlled opposition. So, controlled opposition is Bob Gill's the expert on that.
It's interesting when you talk about controlled opposition because looking at it as a non-junior doctor, all I see is that we've gone from a position of enormous strength and solidarity amongst junior doctors to the whole dispute being dragged out over a period that has left junior
doctors demoralised. Terry, why give Hunt the pleasure of telling us what's in this leak? Well, Hunt's got the pleasure and the convenience of just putting this out whenever he wants, whenever he sees fit, because Hunt's got it all. So... So I don't think it's giving anyone pleasure. I think it's just getting ahead of the news curve and saying that, look, this is in the public domain and this is what's happened, and you can concentrate and move on.
I don't know much about the whole WhatsApp leak thing. All I see is a lack of strength and a lack of leadership coming from the junior doctors' union. You know, I mean, we've got a situation where it's not rocket science to actually get the message to the public that we're talking about patient safety. But for some reason, the BMA's been incapable of actually getting that message across. It's not difficult to say the health secretary wants to stretch 5 days of junior doctors over 7 days without more doctors and without more resources.
But there's been confusion, there's been misinformation, it's just been an absolute
talking
disaster.
Talking about confusion and misinformation, I think one of the biggest pieces of confusion in the public domain at the moment is that the health secretary, and indeed almost the entire media right now, is saying that junior doctors, in rejecting this contract, have gone against the vote and recommendation of the BMA. So basically the Hunt and the media are saying, well, the BMA agreed this contract and now junior doctors are going against their own union. Well, of course, the BMA never ever signed off on this contract. The JDC took a vote to adopt a neutral position and put it to a referendum of junior doctors. That's where you get back to the chair of the JDC, causing all this confusion.
It
is mayhem. I mean, he caused complete and utter mayhem.
I think we should be clear. The chair has changed.
Yeah.
But
in
I mean,
the chair resigned, as I recall, immediately after the junior doctors voted to reject
probably
the contract.
Wise.
That he'd run around recommending. Yeah.
I mean, I did put out a little video when Cameron resigned. We said, "Who's next? Cameron's gone. Who's next? Hunt, Gummer, Malawana." So we've got 226 people watching. That's a split audience, probably doctors, members of the public. What should the doctors do, in your opinion, and what should members of the public do?
You know, we're awaiting, of course, the outcome of the Justice for Health case. And I think it's due on Wednesday. Mm-hmm. Is that right? Mm-hmm. You know, let's hope that that goes in favour of junior doctors. There could, of course, be an appeal. We don't know. But, you know, my thought on this was always that in order to achieve the result that junior doctors wanted, and that is a contract that is safe for both doctors and patients, then it was going to take toe-to-toe
slugging
it
out
with the government.
So mass resignation, not a good idea?
Well, I would not be in favour of mass resignation, because for me, resigning is walking away from the fight, and I'm for being in the fight. Okay, so I'm not for surrendering and walking away from the fight. But you need strength, you need solidarity, you need strong leadership. And pulling away from industrial action, when the whole point of the industrial action was because you were worried about patient safety.
So what can doctors do? What can doctors do? What can members of the public do?
Well, my view is that the government has backed you into a corner where an industrial action is your only recourse. So it seems bizarre that you would walk away from industrial action, because the whole point of industrial action was not to put patients at risk of injury. It was actually to stop patients from being injured, potentially even killed, by this new contract. And if the only way to prevent that from happening is industrial action, then so be it. If the government is forcing you to industrial action.
So Brian said, will the Department of Health get round Justice for Health by saying that it's NHS employers that are imposing? That's quite an interesting point.
Well, that's a question for you as a junior doctor. I mean, it's quite possible, of course, that
I think that's the risk. But then
surely industrial action has to be back on the table, because
you
where
would
do
have
you
thought
go
so,
if
but
that,
with this
if
lot,
the outcome?
With this lot, I mean, I've done a few videos about the BMA. The ones that are kind of relevant is, one, are they incompetent, ineffectual, and or, I can't remember the other word, inept, I think. And I've also said they're as useful as a chocolate teapot. And I pay 30 quid a month for this. Mm. 30 quid a month. Mm. Because I'm not locuming anymore, because this has got potentially a little bit too political, I think I might use that 30 quid a month and just fund this, because I think this is more... This is getting in touch with the public
more. I think the difficulty that you've had as junior doctors is that the BMA has never really understood how a union represents its members. in a fight like this. You know, I mean, I so many times I saw, oh, this isn't political. Well, you know, you're actually in a battle with the government. You don't get much more political than that.
Of course it's political.
Yeah.
I'm quite concerned about, you know, people that are coming out and saying this is, make it apolitical, this is apolitical. I think anybody that says this is apolitical, they need their head at examining. And I'm happy from an A&E point of view to have a look at it and check it out. I just think it's mad.
Even if we just leave aside the government's wider agenda on privatisation of the NHS and we put that on the shelf, you know, this is a fight with the government over its intention to impose an unfair, unsafe contract. You know, I've said this before. In fighting imposition alone, I believe that junior doctors have been holding the line between democracy and dictatorship in this country.
And the survival of the NHS.
If the government gets away with imposing an unfair, unsafe, discriminatory contract on junior doctors, we're all next. It's that simple.
Nurses, everyone else, I completely agree. Yeah. I mean, my concern with this was, you know, the BMA never really wanted to. They were happy to march with nurses. They were happy to get nurses to do some of the donkey work, some of the leg work.
But were they happy to march with nurses?
I take it back. They were happy to get nurses to march with them and to help them out. But I don't really see the support from the BMA in terms of nurses. And I've spoken to lots of nurses that feel let down, feel sold out, and I'd be inclined to agree with them. Remember in London, we're at the People's Assembly March for Health, Home, Action and Jobs. No BMA presence whatsoever. No. A few doctors came down, but no BMA presence.
No, this is true. You know, something that's always struck me is this. I was literally asked the day before the October Junior Doctors rally last year to go along and speak, and I was really surprised when I turned up at the rally to discover that in fact it had been arranged and funded by the junior doctors themselves. The BMA had not taken a role in arranging that October rally.
I think
the position changed.
That did change. The second rally. I asked. I wanted to speak, and I was too controversial. I was going to mention.
I was told that I wasn't able to either because, of course, I'm way too political, I suppose, and too angry when I speak.
When you get on a stage.
Yeah, no stopping me.
So I'm going to answer the two questions that I asked you because I've got to at least practice to pretend to try and be an interviewer because that's what I'm trying to do.
What are the questions?
You've forgotten. So what should the public do? What should doctors do moving forward?
Okay.
If you want to answer those questions, I'll let you answer. If not, I'll just do it.
Moving forward, just talking about the public, you know, I mean, I'm a member of the public. We're on junior doctors' side. You know, the junior doctors are the most caring, kind people in this country. You know, it's
what
a
can
vacation.
They do next?
You know,
I'm going to be like Paxman.
The public,
Mr. Stefanovic, what can they do next?
The public has to support them.
How can the public support them?
By supporting them.
My first try at confrontational interview.
Through industrial action. I mean, it seems to me that industrial action is the only realistic recourse for junior doctors, and all you can do is ask the public to be as understanding as they possibly can and as supportive as they possibly can, because although there will be, or they
email
would
email the
be,
BMA, would tweet
be,
the BMA,
although there would be disruption for the public if industrial action takes place, you've got to look at the wider picture here. And the reason
I think, wait, even if there's disruption for the public, the sad thing is, which the BMA seems to have forgotten, is that we've got consultant colleagues, we've got nursing colleagues, we've got allied health professionals that cover that and make that strike safe.
Yeah.
And the BMA have backed themselves into a corner now because they've said that they will never strike if the Department of Health says, I'm probably talking myself out of a job in the Department of Health, and you as well, unfortunately, but they have said that they will not strike if the Department of Health says that it's unsafe. So any plans that the BMA come forward with now, all the Department of Health have to say is unsafe, and they're not going to strike.
I've not heard that.
Yep.
Is that the case?
Yep. Yeah.
Well, hold on one moment. So let me see if I've got this straight, okay? The BMA, if you're right, I don't know, I'm taking your on what you've read here, but if the BMA has said that it will not strike, if the Department of Health says it would not be safe for junior doctors to strike, then in essence what the BMA is saying is, well, we accept that this contract is unfair and it's unsafe for patients and doctors.
And
it's
discriminatory, and we're still going to take your 30 quid a month.
Because doctors are being stretched over 7 days, so 5 days of doctors are being stretched over 7 days, and that's unsafe for doctors and patients. And patients could be injured or killed. Doctors could be injured or killed. Tired doctors driving home have been injured and killed already. So where does that leave us? I'm sorry, that makes no sense whatsoever. What the BMA should be saying right now is we are taking industrial action because we are being forced to take industrial action because this government wants to impose an unfair, unsafe contract on us. And this is the only way that we can stop that. We're trying to save lives.
How are you doing? Moxeith, one of my old Regis is now consultant. He said something about agree ruthless mass resignation with full support from consultants. That's the only resort left. Sadly, the BMA have boxed themselves out. You know, industrial action's not going to happen.
There isn't any real difference between mass resignation and industrial action. And I'm all for staying in the fight, you know. And I always see that, you know, resignation as walking away.
Yeah, giving up.
We know that junior doctors have got strength. We know they've got solidarity because we've seen it in the past. What they lack right now is leadership.
And Ian says, just tell the public straight, if junior doctors blow the whistle on unsafe practice, they get sacked.
Yeah,
I agree.
And we come back there to poor Chris Day and his case. You know, a terrific young doctor with a young family abandoned by the BMA to pursue a case for whistleblowing protection for every single doctor in the
Bridget,
country.
Hey, Bridget, how are you doing? So BMA asked health professionals to engage with their decision. I'm very unclear as to what that means. Seems BMA accepting the contract as they state they will facilitate the... ..... I haven't considered the rest of it. Hey, Glenn, you're right. Looking forward to seeing you in Hartlepool soon.
I'm in Hartlepool, we're meeting up again at the Hubble, how convenient. I'm in Hartlepool, everybody. Yes.
Not now, you're in Liverpool.
Now, I'm in Liverpool right now.
But yeah, so we're meeting up, we're becoming a bit of a double act.
Thank goodness you reminded me that I'm actually going to Hartlepool.
15th of October, yeah. Glenn Hughes, yeah. 999, crash call for the NHS, another rally. Will that be an angry speech, do you think?
Always. Before we finish this evening, if I could just say again, tomorrow, 12 noon, Derby Square, Liverpool, there will be a rally, a march for justice for our miners. Please come and support our miners. They were there for us when we needed them. Please be there.
So in the short term, i.e. tomorrow, focus on the miners. Let's really support them. Let's help them. Let's give that a bit of a splash. Let's share all that. I'll be there. I'll be streaming it. We'll be putting it out through WattMed. And then moving forward, let's take this fight to the government. We can do this together.
Yeah.
We can definitely do this together.
You can win this.
Look, somebody from the team. I was thinking double act. Hi, Peter. That's not me. I didn't type that.
Yeah. No.
No, I actually didn't. I know people think I did. So Watford are starting in about 7 minutes. And that's got nothing to do with why I'm going.
Right,
but
you?
I'm ready to change into this. Thanks very much for watching. I really appreciate it. Have you got any last words?
Just stand together. You know, solidarity, strength, you've got it. You know, I believe in you. The public believes in you. You can still win this if you stand together.
Very good. Cheers. I feel a bit sad to go, don't you? This is kind of like the outtakes at the end. Do you know any good jokes?
I'm not telling jokes. I'm too angry to tell jokes.
Too angry. Okay, yeah, no. You're not angry.
Okay.
You're angry tomorrow.
Everybody. I've got to go.
Okay. Is it soon? Bye.